Thank you so much for joining Cafe Informed. Today's Thursday, and I'm so glad that each and every one of you were able to join us again. Thank you so much. As you know, Cafe Informed is a program that is hosted by CAF, Center for Assisting to Families, Centro de Apoyo Familiar, CAF, and we are here to help. We're here to empower you with information and resources so you can make a difference in your community. So today we have an amazing guest. She's gonna be speaking to us about census, but not only census, she's also gonna share some of the amazing work she's done in the community as a community engagement person for the University of Maryland. Her name is Gloria Aparicio, and she's gonna be talking to all and every one of you about Census 2020 and how you and I can make a difference today. Gloria, thank you so much for joining us and for being here with us.
Thank you, Wakiria. This is so nice to be here with your group, with your audience. You have done a tremendous work in the community, so I'm so excited to be part of your show, and I'm glad to talk to your audience.
Thank you. Gloria, tell me a little bit about the work that you've done in the community as, you know, in the University of Maryland, how long you've been working for the University of Maryland, what are the services that you provide or your, as you know, your department, and how, you know, of course, people can reach out to you.
Sure. No, thank you. Thank you for this opportunity. Yes, I've been at the University of Maryland for the past 23 years. I graduated from the University of Maryland, but then I went out and then they recruited me back, which I'm so thankful and grateful because I'm the founder of the Office of Community Engagement.
Wow.
And the beauty of that was because I saw the tremendous potential for us to be connecting our campus community with the surrounding neighbors, with the state of Maryland, but more importantly, with the surrounding neighbors. We have an amazing community in Landley Park, Riverdale, Hyattsville, you name it. They are so so full of diversity and all of that great connection that we decided, you know, why not? Why not doing more work? Going inside of the university, what I do, I meet with the faculty, staff, and the students, and even alumni. They come to me and they say, well, Gloria, we are doing certain projects, and we would like to have a partnership with the community, with a community-based project that we not only the one giving, but we're also getting from our communities to be having this something that is beneficial, mutually beneficial. So then I just go out and then see what the community would like to be working with us. I would like to do some project with us. They might have an issue. They might have an asset that they would like to highlight in the work in the community. So then I bring all those two together and then we'll make the connections and make things happen. So this has been a tremendous opportunity for us to work with the schools in the area from K through 12, Prince George's school system. We try to work with them from pre-K to high school. We also wanted to work with organizations like you. I know that the School of Public Health has a lot of great programs with you, Wakiria, and your organization. So things like that, that's what I want to go out. And, you know, sometimes my colleagues will think about, they have friends on other, you know, other jurisdictions, any other counties and all of that, and which is great, and other states, as a matter of fact. But I always tell them, you know, across the street, you can find that and then start kind of planning those things. And once you have something ready to go and explore and expand it, but at least we give the opportunity to our people that is next to us. And that has been a great way to get more people engaged and involved from the university. In the past, I used to beg a lot. I started asking everybody, can you please do this? Now the phone is going off the hook, getting our office to connect them. And with the situation that we're living in, that they know how Prince George's has been impacted by COVID-19, this race relation issue that we want to be part of the conversation with the Latino community and all of that, I bring all of them together, and we're doing so many great things that can say that the university has their commitment as a public service institution to really do it with the stories, with things that they are coming out that really are helping our community, for sure.
Amazing. I really applaud you for what you're doing. And also, you know, to have a voice in the University of Maryland, and you all over the place, like every topic, every subject matter, you always try to be engaged and involved and connect our community with, you know, important issues that are going on at the University of Maryland. So I thank you for that, and I'm very grateful to have met you, because my organization has been involved in way more things, way more activities and programs in partnership with the university after you and I connected. So that's really, really helpful. And today you and I, we're dealing with a subject that is the census. And I know for many of us, this is a very important matter, because from there, we're talking about millions of dollars that can flow to our state and to our cities based on our participation. So tell me about all the work that you're doing, and let us educate the listeners, those who are listening and watching this program, why this is so important.
Yeah, so two years ago, I was participating in a conference where they were talking about census, and they described something related to that in 2010, our area was completely undercounted. And then they told the story about what the census is all about. And the census at that moment, they were describing it as, this is the dollars, the resources that are coming to communities for hospitals, for schools, for transportation, for the school lunches for those individuals that are not, they are in Title I schools, or they are poor. So these are the fundings that are coming. These are the funds that are, this data feed the aspect in the government to the federal government to send the resources to the communities, to the states and jurisdictions, depending on the number of people that were counting on the census. Then they talked to us and said, Langley Park, Riverdale, Queen George's County, and other areas in the state of Maryland were undercounted in 2010. So the state of Maryland lose the opportunity to get $1 billion, $1 billion. And Prince George's County didn't get $367 million. I always joke with people, these are no pesos. This is real dollars. And those real dollars are the one that today would have helped us in addressing all these challenges that we're going through COVID-19. Mm-hmm. So what I'm asking the community here, that we need to pay attention. We need to be going right now, when you're listening to me, going to 2020census.gov and complete that online, or call on the phone. The phone is also another way for you to complete the census. Only 10 questions. And at that moment, they were asking us, it's only 10 questions. And they're going to be asking you about your name, your last name, your date of birth, who live in the house, do you own, rent, or any of those things. And then your race, are you white, are you black, are you Latino, are you all this? I'm asking all those questions. So only 10 questions, very easy to do. Then they told us at that conference that one of the areas that we're having a lot of issues are college students. When I hear about the college students, they were not completing the census. So I said, well, there is no way, we have to get involved. We're not only gonna be getting involved just with the University of Maryland students, that we have 40,000 students, 30,000 undergrad and 10,000 in graduate school. We have to get them to be part of this process. So we said it cannot be just only confined to the university. It has to, if we have impacted Prince George's, if I've impacted the state of Maryland, we have to have a bigger voice. And that's when I start working all the Complete Count Committee. So I'm in the Prince George's Complete Count Committee. I'm in the City of College Park Complete Count Committee. I created the Maryland Latino Census Coalition, which is also working to help you work with the State of Maryland Complete Count Committee and Prince George's in general, so that we definitely have a complete and accurate account of our people. So I'm asking everyone that are listening to this program, and I know you have a large audience here, that if you haven't done it, what are you waiting? Mm-hmm. What are you waiting? You are bringing to this community, each person approximately, are bringing $18,000 for the next 10 years. So for every year, we're counting you as $1,800. Do it, add it for 10 years. That is the amount that if you don't count, see, you're not counting yourself for this. If you haven't completed that, we're gonna miss that opportunity. And I'm guaranteed that you will need this, whether it's for transportation, whether it's for the hospital, whether it's for the schools in the area. If it's not for you, it's gonna be for your fellow neighbor, for your fellow human being. So let's do it. It's like the mask. The mask is to protect others from you. So here we're protecting our, we're helping, we're supporting our community by completing the census. Mm-hmm. It is safe. People are afraid to complete. Oh, I don't want the government to know anything about me. This is something that will be very critical for the process of being counted. And having a representation in the Capitol, in Congress, where today we need more voices, voices that represents the value that we have, that we bring in our communities. I think I have covered a little bit of what we need to do.
Oh, definitely. And right now, there is a timeline. I want to people to know what is the urgency that we have. Why we really want to make sure that everybody gets counted before a certain deadline. So let's walk through that deadline.
Listen, right now, we would like for you to complete this before August 11, 08/11. We need to be counted, because at that point, after that, you are going to be getting a census, U.S. Census representative will be start coming into communities and start knocking doors to find out why you haven't completed and get that count right there. So I just want to, if you don't want to be right now, have visitors or have somebody knocking your door, take the moment to go to the 2020census.gov and get completed. Or by phone, you can call them. Or if you have those five letters that you might have received already, you can complete that right down there and put it in the mail. And we have it until October 31st, that you can continue to do it, but for us, for the purpose of completing, of getting our goal is to have around 70% at this point. I'm going to round it off because it's another number, but 70% is a good number for us to complete right now, that then help us and you and the Centro de Apoyo CAF will be able to say, we did it, because that's our goal. Mm-hmm. That's our goal. So we did it. So please, audience, let's do it.
You know, and one thing that I want to add to that is, Gloria, when it comes to the safe part, it is completely safe. For instance, some people might say, well, I'm not an immigrant. You know, maybe dealing with immigration is not my issue, but I probably owe money to the IRS or whatever the case might be. You don't have to worry about that, because those agencies don't talk, you know. So census, IRS, none of the different, federal agencies, they don't speak to the census. So it's completely safe. For instance, there is a 5-year federal prison for those who share the data. And also they have $250,000 fine, yeah, if they ever share it. And I know those people that work for census, they have to make a commitment for life where they cannot share none of the data that is collected through the census.
Yeah. So, and if they do, it will be 72 years down the road. So you will not, you will not be here, I guarantee.
You won't be. Yeah, that's definitely, I don't think we'll be
you
here.
You will not be here. So what I'm going to tell you, audience, is that here's the kick. You have to complete that no matter what. We are right now in a lifeline. Mm-hmm. And the reason is because, as you can see, look at the hospitals right now. Look at the people that are on unemployment. These help to all those agencies to have the resources. Look at CAF. CAF, in order to provide all these wonderful services to you, you are going to be helping them to these organizations so they can continue to do what they do for the community. Mm-hmm. So let's think about, you know, I hear sometimes people will say, oh, I don't have money to give any donation to the church or to my organizations that they have been so helpful to me. Here's the time. This is the time to do. And also I wanted to tell you, there are always bad people out there, and they might be calling you and say, hey, I'm from the census, you have to give me your bank account. No. They cannot be counting you, your bank account. Mm-hmm. The census do not ask about that. The census will not ask about your social security. If you have the social security or your TIN number, they do not ask about this information. So the only thing that they're going to be asking you is about your name, your last name, your date of birth, who live in the house, your race, and then they're going to be asking your phone number if they need to verify something later on. Mm-hmm. And that's it. It mm-hmm. takes 10 minutes. And this information is going to be kept confidential, as I tell you, and as Kiria was mentioning, they are, by law, they cannot share that data with any federal agency, not with any law enforcement area, with your landlord, because some people say, oh my God, my landlord will be getting this data, and I'm renting a room that I shouldn't be. They are not going to be sharing that information. What they want is just to know how many people from zero age, because people were not even adding the newborns or any of that. Now, I will tell you that this census is going to be for individuals that in the address that you're going to be completed for before around April 1st. If you were there in April 1st, that is the address, that's the information that you're going to be providing. Mm-hmm.
So don't wait, no, even 1 minute. Just go to census2020.gov and start filling that out right now. Don't leave for tomorrow or for later what you can do right now. And I'm going to put in the screen right now, the link where you have to go and also the phone numbers. It's very important that you write it down. It's very important, again, that you go to 2020census.gov. And there you'll be able to see exactly where you link. You can use your preferred language. Here is the numbers, the number where to call, 844-330-2020. Just don't wait, not even one more minute. Just go and dial the number. Or if you wanna go to 2020census.gov, just go and respond. I promise you 10 minutes. It won't take you more than that. You know, my family is very big. I have a lot of kids. And I was able to fill it out in 10 minutes. So please just go to 2020census.gov and make sure that you fill it out. And trust me, what is going to be inside of you is a feeling or a sense of responsibility, because that is a responsibility. It's a civic responsibility.
It's a civic duty. Yes, yes. No, this is great. Well, Kiria, you know, thank you once again for having me and in your show. I really, truly appreciate this opportunity. And feel free, I would be glad to come back and tell your audience more about how they can be connected with the university. We'll welcome you too. And if you have already connection with the university, I'm so excited about that. And you have a friend also at the Office of Community Engagement. So feel free to connect, and I'll take you to the whatever you would like to.
Thank you so much. Is there any phone number or email people want to, if they want to reach out to you, how can they do that?
Sure. It's oce@umd.edu. Okay. Easy. It's like the Office of Community Engagement, just the oce.umd.edu. OCE@umd.edu. And if you want to go to the website, it's oce.umd.edu.
Well, you heard that. You know how to get in touch with Gloria. And again, she's a great resource for our community. And I am so grateful and thankful for it, all the work that you're doing. And definitely, we're going to have you back. I want to make sure that everybody knows we are having our first time home buyers seminar, which is coming up. And I always bring this up because that's one of the core services that CAF provide. We are a HUD approved counseling agency. So if you're looking to buy a home, we give you an 8-hour training where you're gonna learn everything from A to Z, how to buy a home, how to get access to down payment assistance program. And also you'll be able to share this information with your next generation. They'll know how to buy a home, and not just how to buy it, but how to keep your home in the future. So you got it. Next training will be the 24th and the 25th. It's gonna be free. It's free. So hear that, it's a free training, and it's gonna be done virtually. So you have no excuse to say that you're not able to do it. So visit our website, www.mycaf.org. Again, it's www.mycaf.org. And there you'll be able to register. Again, thank you, Gloria. It'll be until next time. And I know that I know that we'll celebrate that we met the number. So because of you who are listening and just not listening, you're taking action. Thank you so much, and God bless everyone. Till next Thursday. Bye-bye.